Tentor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Living Hell, The Dark Side of the Civil War by Michael C.C. Adams. Narrated by Mitch Crawford. Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord. He is trampling out the vintage where the grapes of wrath are stored. He has loosed the fateful lightning of his terrible swift sword. His truth is marching on. Julia Ward Howe, The Battle Hymn of the Republic, 1861. Preface. This book paints a graphic picture of the dark side of the Civil War, its pain, heartbreak, and tragedy. It describes the vicious nature of combat, the terrible infliction of physical and mental wounds, the misery of soldiers living amid corpses, filth, and flies. It also concerns the many civilians who endured loss, deprivation, and violations. To understand what the people of that time endured, I have relied heavily on bringing back their candid voices from the hushed past. That these eyewitnesses deserve to be heard again constitutes a core conviction of this book. Because I want them to speak for themselves, I have neither corrected people's grammar nor interrupted their thoughts with that unpleasant expletive, sick, supposedly needed to flag linguistic errors. Instead, I rely on the listener's common sense to grasp the intended meaning of writings through which our forebears sought to reveal what they experienced. To achieve immediacy, I have at times attempted to create a sense of live action, as though we are experiencing an episode on camera. This technique begins in the opening, where we piggyback on Stephen Crane's arresting image of a road that moves with wounded soldiers shambling to the rear, in order to conjure for ourselves a gallery of Americans journeying together down the path of war. Just as Crane's road was not actually in motion, we will not really sprint down a neurasthenia ward with the animated Dr. Weir Mitchell. Nor would we in fact meet individual men from so many different units clustered together as we and they grope through the smoke on a firing line. We are staging a reconstruction, a reenactment, but one in which the players are the original participants. This modest stylistic device in no way distorts or detracts from the original documents, and I hope will prove valuable to the listener. Opening. Jim Conklin and General Sherman. My teenager years in the United Kingdom coincided with the centennial of the American Civil War. For me, the remembrance meant that I could acquire paperbacks normally unavailable to the general reader. Henry Kidd Douglas's I Rode with Stonewall, the memoirs of General Ulysses S. Grant, and the recollections of Confederate Admiral Raphael Semmes. I held a rather innocent view of the war at this time. I harbored romantic notions of dramatic exploits on the battlefield, of boys being forged into men through the ultimate test of combat. In part, Stephen Crane's 1895 novel, The Red Badge of Courage, inspired my vision. I read it in the Classics Illustrated graphic version around the impressionable age of 12, then went on to devour the complete written text, and to see John Huston's evocative 1951 black-and-white movie, in which Audie Murphy played the Green Youth, transformed by the transcendent experience of battle. Henry Fleming's ascent into heroism seized my imagination. In due course, I went to college and graduate school, where I wrote a dissertation on the war that became my 1978 book, Our Masters, the Rebels. In this work, I argued that Union generals, particularly in the East, had a tendency to talk and act as though awed by their rebel opponents, whom they perceived as being from a more martial culture than their own. Their inferiority complex, as we might loosely label it, meant Federal Army commanders lacked offensive spirit, displaying undue caution. Afflictions of the slows even affected their ability to follow up defensive successes, such as at Gettysburg. I still think the thesis has merit, but I now see other reasons why generals were unable to capitalize when an enemy retreated. Their own victorious forces often became too broken and wearied to mount effective pursuit. Today, my teenage images of battle-hardened veterans, endlessly enduring and consistently gallant, succored and sustained by stoic, long-suffering civilians, seem naive and misleading. I understand why Audie Murphy, a veteran who had seen more than enough combat in World War II, found Henry's flag-waving antics after returning to the regiment bitterly silly, and why, during shooting breaks, he wandered off the set as though lost in a distant dream. He had the 2,000-yard stare of the emotionally spent combat soldier. He said as much, recalling, "Before the war, I'd get excited and enthused about a lot of things, but not anymore." In a sense, this development in my understanding mirrors the journey from ignorance to enlightenment described by another combat veteran, General William Tecumseh Sherman. Speaking to a crowd of admirers at the Ohio State Fair on August 11, 1880, Sherman pointedly addressed young people in the crowd, asserting, "There is many a boy here today who looks on war as all glory, but, boys, it is all hell." The general carefully added that he did not espouse pacifism and would serve again if needed, but he urged people to look squarely at war's horrors. I want to stay with this point. I propose that we not go forward to watch Henry Fleming marching exuberantly off the field. He should not look quite so cheerful anyway, as his next rendezvous with battle will be Gettysburg. Instead of moving on, let us dwell a while on the pains, the fears, and the blighted lives, indeed the tragedies of those who became the war's victims, like Jim Conklin, Crane's decent, tall soldier, shot through the body, milling along amid a crowd of other wounded, afraid of being run down by the artillery, wanting to be left alone to die. Jim experienced no transcendence, caught up in the mangle of war, along with many thousands of other men, women, and children. I am by no means the first author to argue for looking starkly at the grim features of the war. Walt Whitman, who worked in Washington, D.C. during the conflict and served as a volunteer hospital nurse, said the real war, the cruel war, would not get into the books. But he tried in his prose and poetry to add some darker shadows. Much later, the distinguished historian Alan Nevins exhorted us to confront the war's hard reality. "We should probe more deeply into roots, a process that will expose some of the weaknesses of our social fabric and governmental system. We should pay fuller attention to its darker aspects and examine more honestly such misinterpretations as the statement it was distinguished by its generosity of spirit, the magnanimity with which the combatants treated each other, a statement absurd on its face, for no war which lasts 4 years and costs 600,000 lives leaves much magnanimity in its later phases. We should above all examine more closely the effects of the great and terrible war, not on the nation's politics, we also know that, but on its character, the vital element of national life." My concerns are not coterminous with those of my distinguished predecessor, although I have become preoccupied, as he was, by the societal aspects of the war more than its politics. Also like him, I do not wish to deny the great issues involved and civic virtue shown, the fighting that produced prodigious courage, sacrifice, endurance, and magnanimity among soldiers and civilians. But I believe strongly that Professor Nevins correctly urged us to dwell more on the dark side. We should remind ourselves now and then about the grimmer realities of this struggle and, perhaps by extension, all armed conflicts. Many books consider in depth this or that important aspect of the bleak war. I hope to perform a service by pulling together all the strands into one large tapestry. The sesquicentennial presents the opportunity to do this, as once again we celebrate the conflict, a word I suspect could not be less appropriate. To begin with, the Civil War's cardinal characteristic became its stunning bloodiness. It may be a commonplace, yet it still shocks us to remember that the fight cost as many lives as all of America's other major wars combined. Equally startling, the butcher's bill came for a contest neither sharply delineated nor fought by combatants bonded together in defense of clearly enunciated positions and universally held ideologies. The politics of division proved so complex, confusing, contradictory, and tangled that even today we hotly debate the reasons for the war. Of course, it would be satisfying if we could find one single straightforward explanation for the war. We try. Thus, one camp sees a clear-cut moral struggle between the forces of slavery and freedom. Agreed, slavery must have been a large factor, probably the biggest one, in the coming of the conflict. After all, the election as president of Abraham Lincoln, who opposed the further extension of slavery, led South Carolina fire eaters to kick the lid off the cauldron and jump inside. Yet, say skeptics, Northern opposition to slavery stayed so lukewarm that Lincoln did not even propose partial emancipation until fall 1862, and then not as a moral crusade, but as a military measure to put new life into the flagging war effort. Many white Northerners embraced racism as much as the next bigot. Free blacks could not vote in much of the North, and several Midwestern states excluded African Americans from living within their borders. Some who downplay the debate over slavery counterclaim that the primary cause of the war may be found in Northern encroachment on Southern rights. Confederates fought a disinterested battle to uphold the principle of a state's right to resist centralized intrusion. Local rights included secession from the Union. Again, the argument has some merit. Whether state or national authority should be paramount got a good airing during the war. But making this legal disagreement the focus of the contest still presents the problem that people do not normally precipitate a bloodbath to test an abstract constitutional principle. Appeals to state sovereignty usually masked other, more pragmatic interests. Southerners embraced states' rights when convenient, but insisted that national authorities return fugitive slaves, overriding the states' rights protest of Northern local officials. Trying to broaden the debate, another school argued that we see an epic confrontation between an aristocratic agrarian South and a bourgeois business-industrial North doomed to collide. Charles and Mary Beard championed this argument between the world wars. It gained popularity both with Marxist historians and conservative apologists for the Old South. There must be some validity to the idea of rising industrial interests squaring off against older entrenched agricultural concerns. But farmers and factory owners do not necessarily have to shoot each other over negotiable issues such as the height of protective tariffs. Midwestern farmers stayed loyal to the Union. The only aspect of Southern agrarianism distinct enough to provoke a war remained plantation slavery. It lay at the base of the Southern way of life. Even though a majority of white people in Dixie might not own slaves, they subscribed to the caste system and could not conceive of a state of society in which blacks were free, let alone equal. So the argument turns full circle and the ravel of causes remains. If we could say one thing with certainty, it would be that the war represented a profound failure of the political system. Discord had broken government. The war does not qualify as a classic tragedy fated to happen. The British Empire had abolished slavery peacefully between 1833 and 1838. Russian Tsar Alexander II ended serfdom without civil war in 1861. Only when the South closed its mind to rational debate of the peculiar institution late in the antebellum period did compromise become impossible in the United States, as Clement Eden pointed out in The Freedom of Thought Struggle in the Old South, 1940. John Brown's 1859 raid on the U.S. Armory at Harper's Ferry, Virginia, although failing to spark a slave revolt, finished driving many Southerners into paranoia. When statesmanship failed, the calamity fell on a people with lives already steeped in hardship and loss. Victorian life, while not idyllic, still led many to see themselves at the apex of human development. They could evidence an intellectual flowering in New England, the polished manners of some Southern gentry, and the growing dynamism of the West that bred vigorous newcomers like the Lincolns, Shermans, and Grants. The rise of the common man meant that more white males voted than ever before. Mass production enhanced daily life with cheap, plentiful goods, from ready-made furniture and clothing to newspapers and books. The middle class expanded, and the prosperous lived well. Yet the mass of people did not. The scientific concept of a balanced nutritional diet, for example, scarcely existed. Many Southern yeomen, along with most poor whites and blacks, subsisted on a vitamin-deficient diet of cornmeal, molasses, and salt pork, leavened by occasional seasonal boilings of greens or beans. Urban workers had neither the time nor money to eat properly, their food often stale, badly cooked, monotonous. Fanny Fern, a pioneering female journalist, wrote in 1855 of cheap boarding houses where clerks, apprentices, and seamstresses bolt their meals with railroad velocity amid soiled tablecloths, sticky crockery, oily cookery. Ice for refrigeration remained scarce. Harriet Beecher Stowe, enduring humid June heat, complained, "I am sick of the smell of sour milk and sour meat and sour everything." Heavy, restrictive dress proved hard to keep clean and impeded overall health. Vests and frock coats encased men like stovepipes. Women's stays constricted the lungs, while layers of pantaloons and petticoats dragged in the muck and caught fire in parlor fireplaces. Poor physical specimens abounded, as army surgeons examining recruits in 1861 could attest. Medical practice stayed close to medieval. Young Sarah Morgan, partially paralyzed when her buggy overturned, endured frequent medical hot cupping and bleeding. "The doctor," she screamed, "has again been murdering me." Drugs to combat disease remained inadequate. A physician lost his daughter to convulsions, having only mustard plasters to fight the illness. Class proved no guarantee against sudden death. Mary and Abraham Lincoln, Verena and Jefferson Davis, Ellen and William T. Sherman, Mary and Robert E. Lee all lost children, as did other prominent couples. Known drugs, heroic remedies, had drastic side effects. Calomel and blue pills, commonly available mercury compounds used to treat bowel disorders, typhoid fever, and much else, produced gum disorders and kidney disease. Chloroform, prescribed for insomnia, and arsenic, found in widely advertised and readily available patent nostrums, killed. Because bacteriology remained in its infancy, public hygiene languished. Cities like Chicago, Baltimore, and Louisville had negligible sewer arrangements. Scavenger pigs ate waste thrown in the streets and became emboldened to attack workers' children. For the poor and vulnerable, such as children under 5, death rates stayed high. Typhus, cholera, and yellow fever struck hard. Almost 8,000 people died in the 1853 New Orleans yellow fever outbreak. The 1849 cholera epidemic killed 5,000 New Yorkers alone. Only 2% of city homes had a water line that might have helped stop this waterborne disease. Rural areas also had no immunity. People built privies too close to kitchens, and animal waste fouled groundwater. At Fort Riley, Kansas, in 1855, cholera killed the commandant's wife and 14 others in one day. the accelerating pace of life added to physical and emotional stress. The telegraph enhanced communication, but had unforeseen consequences, demanding radical human adjustments to technology. For example, the speed of the wire created havoc with military planning. A journalist could inform his newspaper of army movements virtually as they happened. An enemy agent might then relay the information to his side. Infuriated generals put reporters behind the lines or threatened execution. Steam power, applied to travel, propelled railroad locomotives, paddle boats, and screw-driven ships. But heightened speed jangled the nerves of people used to a horse's pace. Trains created air and noise pollution. Henry David Thoreau, seeking solitude at Walden Pond, heard wildlife agitated for hours after an engine roared through. The machine had invaded the garden. Disasters occurred frequently. Cows on the line derailed cars, foreshadowing interstate pileups. Fast steamers blew up. Charles Dickens, voyaging to America, depicted the ship's boiler as a fire in hiding, ready to burst through any outlet, wild with its restless power of ruin and death. In an 1865 shocker, the steamer Sultana, taking home Union prisoners of war, exploded, killing 1,700. To alleviate stress and seize a modicum of comfort, Americans used tobacco with abandon, snuffing, chewing, and lighting up. New Yorkers smoked 75 million cigars a year. People guzzled alcohol freely, along with readily available mood-enhancing drugs. Laudanum conveniently infused the two stimulants and proved handy for keeping children quiescent, daycare being virtually unknown outside of prosperous nurseries. Excessive imbibing caused debilitation, violence, and family abuse. One contemporary estimate had 60,000 homes ruined by drink per year. Drunken brawling infected Congress. In one 1857 scrimmage, a colleague knocked inebriated Representative Lawrence Kite of South Carolina across two tables, a shoe taking off in mid-flight. Americans regarded opium as a beneficial tonic and relaxant. They imported 24,000 pounds through northeastern ports in 1840, rising to 105,000 pounds by 1860. For women, with lives severely restricted by gender roles, opium served a similar function to Valium, prescribed in the 1950s for bored and depressed housewives. Alice James, sister of Henry and William, suffered attacks of neuralgia bordering on hysteria. Too bright for her stifling role, she fantasized knocking her father's head off while he sat stiffly reading. Instead, she resorted to self-medication, as did Mary Boykin Chestnut, one of the sharpest minds of the period. Denied the active public life of her senator husband, James, she struggled against overuse of opium and its derivative, morphine. We consider the 19th century a simpler, saner, more grounded time than our own. Yet it looks similar in many ways. A grave equality gap existed between rich and poor. Hostility to immigrants manifested itself in a nativist movement. People found distraction in coarse entertainments such as freak shows, cockfights, gambling, and bare-knuckle boxing. They followed the latest fashions and fads. Prominent British personalities exercised their fascination. The public avidly followed the indiscretions of the randy Prince of Wales or the handsome stage star, Frances Anne Fanny Kemble. Their faces adorned engravings, mugs, and handkerchiefs, to be superseded in 1861 by pinups of generals. Youth did not necessarily behave better. Bachelor young men rioted in their off hours, fighting pit bulls, getting stewed, and joining violent gangs. Elders protested against the fecklessness of their juniors. James Henry Hammond, a seaboard planter, called his boys dead weights that only hunted and fished. They growl, grumble, sulk, and do nothing, he complained. We easily exaggerate Victorian sexual probity. Limited contraception produced unwanted pregnancies. One physician estimated in 1860 that 20% of such cases terminated in abortion. Venereal disease thrived alongside prostitution. Many women without male support felt obliged to sell themselves for food. They faced an alternative of underpaid domestic service, with the threat of being forced by male household members or doing work in factories with typical 14-hour days and minimal safety standards. Accidents in plants occurred frequently due to owner negligence. New York attorney George Templeton Strong recorded in his diary on January 11, 1860, that in Lawrence, Massachusetts, a huge factory, long notoriously insecure and ill-built, suddenly collapsed into a heap of ruins. Some 500 or 600 operatives went down with it, young girls and women mostly. Strong wondered if Southern slaveholders could possibly treat their workers any worse than did the misanthropes of the North. The attorney had a point. Poor life expectancy and bad working conditions in the industrial North and in England often exceeded those on the plantation. But one factor separated slaves' status from any other and made it uniquely awful. They were property. This allowed Lincoln to quip that although many held slavery to be a good, none wanted it for themselves. State and national authorities deprived slaves of all civil and human rights. The U.S. Supreme Court held that they could not seek redress in court. They could not testify against a white. Slaves found themselves denied education, beaten, raped, and mutilated with impunity. The auction block separated slave families forever. Uncle Tom in Harriet Beecher Stowe's 1852 novel endures the grim fate of being sold away from his loved ones downriver to Louisiana. There, Simon Legree, a New England Yankee, that complexity again, exploits land and people with equal callousness, thrashing Tom to death. Possibly while working a flatboat to New Orleans, Lincoln developed his repugnance to the peculiar institution, and, of course, South Carolina's hostility to Old Abe precipitated America's most destructive war. Just how bloody became this conflict that engulfed the troubled land? Perhaps as many as 620,000 military died, 360,000 from the North, 260,000 from the South. To give some context, soldiers had a 1 in 4 chance of dying, versus 1 in 126 for Korea. Civil War military fatalities outnumbered U.S. losses in World War II by 50%. The statistics jar us even more if we consider losses as a percentage of population. A reliable estimate holds that at least 2% of Americans alive in 1860 died in uniform. This translates to more than 6 million today. Union losses represented 1.6% of loyal state residents, the equivalent of 4.8 million now. Rebel dead, at 2.9% of white and black folk, equates to a stunning 8.7 million currently. And these figures fail to address the thousands that were physically or mentally maimed, or the civilians who suffered loss, malnutrition, displacement, death. I intend to place center stage the dark side of the war glimpsed in these figures. Author William Dean Howells said that Americans will only embrace tragedy if it ends happily. This implies that we must march on with Henry, wrapped in his red badge of courage. But I believe listeners will wish to stay back with me for a while, walking along that road where poor Jim Conklin staggers by amid a torrent of hurt humanity. Broken-hearted Mary Lincoln weeps beside Verena Davis, and peppery General Sherman peers into hell. In the 8 chapters that follow, we will escort the listener down the dirty, dusty road of war, in a logical progression from military enlistment to camp, then on the march, to the battlefield, and from there to the hospital, the grave, and the haunted minds of psychologically damaged soldiers. As we draw the listener along, the landscape grows ever darker when we deal with massive civilian deprivation and social dislocation, invasion, and violations. The road then stretches away to the far horizon, charting some legacies of the war, even down to 2012. Finally, in the closing, we will take one more walk together, conjure up the year 1898, and imagine we find ourselves on a dusty lane in Texas, leading to the nearby railroad tracks. There, a last great sadness awaits us. Chapter 1. Gone for a Soldier. As we begin our journey down the road of war, we will sense around us an air of exuberant patriotism, because the bracing clarity of a call to arms has replaced the stress and uncertainty of the secession crisis. We will see boys invigorated by being asked to play a man's role. But dark shadows soon gather, for the exciting road leading into army life also delivers up disease, death, and disillusionment. Youths who have dreamed only of glory will be appalled by the reality, not only of battle, but of daily military routine, with its lowly toil, verbal and physical abuse, brutal and degrading punishments. Liquor and sexual excess lure some and disgust others. Recruits succumb to illness, not just venereal disease and alcoholism, but such camp sicknesses as measles, mumps, and nostalgia. When volunteer enthusiasm fails, both sides resort to compulsion. But conscription laws tend to favor the rich and so ultimately produce a violent reaction, including armed resistance. To meet its manpower needs, the Union reluctantly authorized black recruitment. Many persons of color welcomed this opportunity with its promise of racial advancement, yet they continued to face abuse and exploitation in a fundamentally racist society. To begin, cheerfulness verging on euphoria greeted the cannon fire of April 1861. Many citizens felt relief that the wearing political bickering had ended. Southerners readied themselves to defend home and fireside from Yankee invasion. Northerners prepared to avenge the insult to old glory and preserve mankind's best hope, the Union. Ella Thomas, a young woman from a prosperous Georgia slaveholding family, felt no man should stay in the lap of inglorious ease when threats to the homeland existed. Her husband, brother, and brother-in-law all answered the call. She felt proud to see them exhibit the noble, manly spirit which prompts them to go. After all, she felt, the fighting would be short, easily won by Southern cavaliers, each of whom could whip about a half dozen degenerate, money-grubbing Yankees. Some fire eaters even promised to lap up any blood spilled in civil war. In the North, swelling enlistments promised regeneration for a section that seemingly had too often compromised to preserve a dishonorable peace, one designed to guarantee the continued flow of Southern cotton and capital to Northern factories and banks. "A nation hath been born again, regenerate by a second birth," boomed the poet W.W. Howe. "No more sordid deals," declared Wisconsin's Madison State Journal. "A people long grown, servile-necked, with bowing under mammon's yoke, had come to its senses, and today stand haughtily erect." Mothers might worry about the fate of their soldier sons, but girls inflamed by patriotic fervor insisted the beau sign up. "If a fellow wants to go with a girl now, he had better enlist," opined a volunteer. Older men could look with jaundiced eye at the coming fratricidal bloodshed and the infatuation of youth with the shallow trappings of patriotism. Virginian William Thompson told his fire-eating son, The young and sanguine are rapidly carried away into dreamy fields and flawed visions. But a younger man, the New York's 7th Major Theodore Winthrop, better captured popular sentiment. Billeted in Washington at the Capitol, he determined the presence of troops in our palace necessary to amend the cowardice, bosh, and imbecility of the politicians who had here cooperated to corrupt and blind the minds of the people. War allowed youth to assume a man's role while fleeing workaday grind and tedium. At the start of Moby Dick, 1851, Herman Melville pictured office workers, stapled to their desks, who spent Sundays lining New York's wharves and piers, longingly scanning the ocean skyline for hints of adventure. He also created Bartleby the Scrivener, 1853, a clerk who exemplifies the alienation of labor. Paralyzed by the soul-destroying work of sorting dead letters and copying documents, Bartleby becomes mentally and physically stultified, wasting away in a poorhouse. Robert Gould Shaw of the Boston elite, far more privileged than Bartleby, nevertheless cried out, "I am a slave now," after he graduated from Harvard and entered his uncle's mercantile business. He escaped into uniform early in the conflict. Boys, stigmatized as feckless by their elders, now turned the argument, posturing in the role of manly patriots. "We've been told of our degeneracy for years," wrote Henry Lee Higginson, son of a wealthy Boston merchant. "But," he added proudly, "the boys were proving to be the same men who fought in 76, 1,000 times better than any soldiers living." Service, deemed a rite of passage into manhood, brought boys eagerly flocking to the colors. Recruiters obliged them. "I didn't tell them that I was only 15, so I became a soldier," wrote Thomas Galway, a youngster from Cleveland, Ohio, who joined the Union Army in April 1861. Randolph Shotwell from North Carolina enlisted because it meant the complete cutting loose from boyhood to assume the responsibilities and perils of manhood. Research suggests that both the innocence and enthusiasm of adolescents encourage volunteering. Boys in their late teens comprised the largest category of soldiers at 40-50% of the whole. About 250,000 were just entering the teen years. These exuberant adolescents, packed with adrenaline, threw their capes in the air and capered for civilians peering at their camps from passing trains. Joseph E. Crowell, a New Jersey volunteer, doubted that patriotism had motivated most boys to enlist. "To many, it was a change from the ordinary humdrum of life. Others looked upon it as a picnic. And then, in every boy's heart, there is an inherent spirit of adventure." To poor and unemployed men, service offered a chance to gain self-respect and the promise of a steady wage, which subsequently created bitterness when pay became late. Enoch T. Baker, a Pennsylvania volunteer, wrote in late 1861 to his wife, who fretted about his leaving, "You know, if I could have got work, I would not have left you or the children." Recent immigrants, often out of work or marginally employed in the worst jobs, could hope for financial stability in the military and a potential leg up into cultural acceptance by mainstream Americans. 500,000 foreigners wore blue, including 150,000 Irish out of a total immigrant base of 1.5 million in 1860. Lesser numbers of Germans, Italians, Russians, Hungarians, and other Europeans fought for the Union. Fewer foreign nations were represented in gray, as many immigrants avoided the slave states because of distaste for human bondage or a reluctance to compete for jobs with a servile workforce. Inevitably, military fervor began to dissipate. We cannot say precisely when, but a fair estimate might be the spring of 1862. What caused the initial zeal to wane? First, exposure to battle proved sobering, even horrifying. We shall explore the subject of combat fully in chapters 3 and 5, but we should mention the experience here just as a factor in declining enthusiasm. Romantic illusions failed to survive battle's grim truths. Recruits had been imbued with Currier and Ives' artful depictions of war, in which serried ranks of gaily uniformed soldiers, led by plumed officers on horseback, charged beyond the fallen, who assumed restful poses. Such fantasies bore no relation to the reality of metal projectiles disintegrating fragile bodies as men screamed and cried. By August 1862, William Chun of the 40th Georgia, serving in the Western regiments, had decided that there existed no beauties in the preparation for the wholesale slaughter of the human race. I see no glory in numbering those on the battlefield slain. It is nothing but horror, from beginning to end. Elisha Stockwell believed himself to be the only survivor of Company 1, 14th Wisconsin, at Bloody Shiloh, April 6, 1862. Cowering under shellfire, his mind drifted back to my home, and I thought what a foolish boy I was to run away to get into such a mess I was in. Fighting no longer seemed the answer for Theodoric Montfort, a lieutenant in the 25th Georgia, who watched as the surgeon lay out his grisly instruments in anticipation of Yankee warships beginning the bombardment of Fort Pulaski, Georgia, on March 31, 1862. "What a calamity is war," he moaned. "When will men cease to fight and love their neighbors as themselves?" Captured when the fort fell, Montfort died in a Union prison that September. William B. Green of the 2nd United States Sharpshooters had enlisted in a flush of patriotic fervor at 17. He quickly became disillusioned with the hard routine of Army life and discovered the actual experience of combat appalled him. At Cedar Mountain, on September 7, 1862, his unit was stationed in a copse. Rebel artillery shells smashed the treetops, bringing down vicious splinters of wood upon the sharpshooters. Canister, containing pieces of shell, railroad spikes, small bullets, etc., made up some rounds. Terrified, Green burrowed into the earth, later writing his mother that "the marks where I stuck my face into the ground must still be visible." Although unwounded, he now started feigning illness to get a discharge and narrowly escaped trial as a deserter. A comrade unsuccessfully attempted suicide with his bayonet in a drastic bid to escape the service. Long casualty lists from unexpectedly bloody fields, amplified by soldiers' letters vividly describing combat and the death of friends, doused homefront enthusiasm. Due to advances in photography, civilians could virtually experience the horror by peering at plates of the bloated dead displayed in store windows. You might examine corpses in 3D by purchasing a stereoscopic viewer. The photographer, said the New York Times, October 20, 1862, has done something to bring home to us the terrible reality and earnestness of war. If he has not brought bodies and laid them in our dooryards and along streets, he has done something very like it. Soldiers widely interpreted civilian disillusion, even though it largely mirrored their own, as cynical avoidance of service to make money while soldiers risked their lives for less pay than a streetcar driver. By mid-1863, the Union Army of the Potomac's General Alpheus T. Williams thought that veteran resentment of civilian selfishness hurt reenlistment. Georgia Private William Sutwell wrote from Fredericksburg, Virginia, in August 1863, that greed and godlessness undermine the cause. "We seek the creature, not the creator." As early as 1861, prominent Northern literary figure Henry Tuckerman had predicted glumly that idealism would wane in the face of fever-ridden camps, along with a material prosperity that set new records for extravagance and renewed political quarreling. The fading sacrificial spirit indicated that unity, initially fragile, had begun to fracture among civilians and soldiers. Confederate Colonel Williams C. Wickham, anticipating combat at Fredericksburg, December 1862, thought it a damned shame to die for a cause of which I do not approve. Charles B. Hayden of the 2nd Michigan, serving in Virginia in late 1862, overheard rival pickets agreeing the fighting made no sense. Why not throw our guns into the river and end the damned war? The Richmond government's steady encroachment on states' rights antagonized Southerners, while the Emancipation Proclamation divided the North. Officers resigned commissions. Some were cashiered, like Tennessee General James G. Spears, a brigade commander in the Union Army of the Ohio, broken for threatening to change sides, swearing, "God damn the government, let her go to hell." Men who expected the military to rise above the petty squabbles of civil life became disaffected when promotion failed to recognize merit. Passed over officers, such as Ella Thomas's husband, Jefferson, who in 1861 thought it noble to serve in a Virginia regiment, resigned in high dudgeon the following year. Disgust with dissension in the high command furthered disaffection. Lack of success among Confederate generals in the West and Union commanders in the East bred recrimination and infighting. Captain William Lusk of the 2nd New York, furious at antagonisms among generals that helped cause Union defeat at Second Bull Run, a debacle in which he participated, complained that there is no head on the field, only lying reports, and old Abe makes a joke. Discipline quickly made soldiers who had anticipated heroic escapades feel more like prisoners than some legendary Achilles. The boys counted the days yet remaining before they would be discharged, the same as a convict does the remaining days of his imprisonment, confided Private Crowell. Soldiers had little more freedom than the slave, swore New York Private Charles Gould. Similarly, from camp at Fort Bliss, Texas, June 1861, a rebel cursed his captain as a surly dictator who treats us more like slaves than anything else. Drilling elicited derision, as did woodcutting and digging latrines. Spit and polish, scouring equipment with saliva and dust, seem servile. Army life comes hard sometimes for young men who have been raised to do no menial labor, admitted Georgia Private Theodore Fogel, slaving away in Richmond, Virginia in July 1861. Nurses, too, became disenchanted, emptying slop pails instead of tending wounded gallants. John H. Brinton, a Union surgeon stationed at Cairo, Illinois for much of 1861, said that many females flouted rules and expected dining service. He groused uncharitably, "Can you fancy half a dozen or a dozen old hags surrounding a bewildered hospital surgeon, each one clamorous for her little wants?" Comparisons to slavery were not hyperbole. Many military penalties echoed the degrading inflictions that marked the plantation and jail. Punishments included hanging by the thumbs, toes barely touching the ground, bucking and gagging, being trussed like a turkey with a bit cutting the mouth, spread-eagling on a spare wheel, mocking crucifixion, flogging, and branding. The horror of being ordered to brand a deserter during the 1864 Virginia Wilderness Campaign permanently unhinged Union surgeon William Chester Minor. Severity of punishment often appeared disproportionate. General Samuel Heintzelman spread-eagled an orderly on an artillery wheel simply for not removing his hat. This caused excruciating pain, according to Private Frank Wilkeson, 11th New York Artillery, Army of the Potomac. The victim's agony increased if tied horizontally, the body pulling heavily and cuttingly on the cords that bound his upper arm and leg to the wheel. Soldiers felt officers habitually abused rank by bullying. A pilferer hit by General George Gordon Meade swore, "If it weren't for them shoulder straps of yourn, I'd give you the damnedest thrashing." Harshness invited retaliation. Men of the 40th New York en route to the front in Virginia, September 1861, endured frequent bucking and gagging at the hands of their colonel. Outraged, they openly swear that they will shoot him the first time they have a battle with the enemy. When Lieutenant P.T. Keyes, 16th U.S. Infantry, Army of the Ohio, struck a straggler, the victim pledged, "I'll shoot you the first chance I get." The officer died in the next action. Officers often deemed severe discipline a necessity and in the soldier's interest, for disobedience threatened life and health. In September 1861, Robert E. Lee wrote that many trainees had smallpox and measles. "They bring it on themselves by not doing what they are told. They are worse than children, for the latter can be forced." Other officers did not spare the rod and spoil the child, forcefully confronting insubordination, especially in incidents involving alcohol and firearms. On April 12, 1863, Union General Michael Corcoran shot a drunken sentry who four times called him a goddamned Irish son of a bitch. Captain Nathaniel Southgate Shaler, commanding the 5th Kentucky Battery, U.S., during the 1862 defense of Cincinnati, Ohio, knocked flat one of his men, a bully of women and a drunkard, who had attacked him while resisting arrest. Shaler spread-eagled the gunner on a wheel unit. When nearly dead, he says he'll soger. For heinous crimes, soldiers faced execution. James Preble of the 12th New York, guilty of rape, caught drunk, with his privates hanging out, was shot. Vice proved a bane of army life, even though officers, surgeons, families, ministers, and community leaders urged soldiers to adhere to a regimen of moral and physical cleanliness. Victorians preached the concept of death before defilement. Harriet Beecher Stowe felt happy that boys embraced war as a bride and are ready to die. But she fretted about her son Fred's exposure to soldier sins. Hard drinking headed the sinner's list. Many older men were habituated boozers, but imbibing also became a form of self-medication to ease miseries of mind and body. For many youngsters away from home constraints for the first time, acquiring the liquor habit made you a bold dog. Keeping the boys from liquor proved almost impossible. Corporal C.F. Boyd of the 15th Iowa, in camp at St. Louis, February 1862, watched his comrades getting pretty old at the business of running the guard to reach local saloons. "There seems to be no God here, but more than the average amount of devil," he said of duty in the city. Nurse Louisa May Alcott characterized D.C. as a city half of whose male population seemed to be taking the other half to the guardhouse. The soldier's nose for booze appeared uncanny. "Despite all precautions," wrote Albert Fall, a gunner in Porter's Tennessee Battery, CSA, from Bowling Green, Kentucky, December 1861, "a sergeant got tight and was engaged with his corporal, who was also drunk, in loading and firing a horse trowel." Desperate officers dismissed sutlers, authorized merchants, and even flogged civilians who peddled liquor, but the flow continued. The concentration of troops in Richmond, the Confederate capital, overwhelmed the Provost Guard's resources. In a March 1862 diary entry, Edmund Ruffin, a passionate secessionist, reluctantly admitted that the city seemed reduced to a sinkhole of drunkenness, rowdyism, and crime. The rough company encountered in the army encouraged other vices, such as gambling and theft. Cornelia Hancock, a Union assistant surgeon with the Army of the Potomac, wrote after having her saddle stolen by soldiers, "The depravity of persons in the army is beyond belief." But the one abuse that joined alcohol as most damaging to soldiers' health and efficiency proved to be sexual promiscuity. No certain cures existed for the venereal diseases that, at times, threatened radical consequences, destroying the immune system and attacking the brain. They also proved highly infectious. Mercurial compounds served as the most common treatment, leading to the witticism, "A Night with Venus, A Lifetime with Mercury." Syphilis vaccination, created from active matter, proved risky and largely ineffective. Union Colonel John F. Williams reported his unit so weakened by syphilis from vaccination that they cannot furnish many men for scouting purposes. Without good cures, the regulation of brothels probably proved the best prophylactic, ensuring uninfected women and clean establishments. In Nashville, for example, General R.S. Granger ordered the hospitalization of prostitutes likely to spread disease. The dimensions of the task ensured failure. D.C. alone boasted some 450 brothels, with 7,000 women. These houses of ill repute continued to be unhygienic. A provost's guard raiding the hospital, a bordello near the Capitol, encountered sickening stench, filth, and a soldier in a louse-ridden bed. Prostitutes followed the armies. The Louisiana Tigers brought with them into service disgusting-looking creatures, passed off as ministering angels. The Christian Commission and other benevolent groups helped in the moral struggle, distributing Bibles and cautionary tracts, but the fight continued uphill. Older soldiers got horny, and virgin youths wanted to experience sex before dying. Said Private Hayden of the 2nd Michigan in May 1861, "If the men pursue the enemy as vigorously as they do the whores, they will make very efficient soldiers." Away from the restraints of society and of home, observed Private Wilbur Fisk, 2nd Vermont, Army of the Potomac in late 1863, "It is the easiest thing in the world to drop in with the current, call it the soldier style, live while you do live, and let the end take care of itself." Probably 1 in 12 Civil War soldiers contracted a social disease. The Union Army alone reported some 73,000 cases of syphilis and 109,400 of gonorrhea. Many hospitals dedicated a ward to VD. The epidemic hurt military functioning. Army of Northern Virginia General A.P. Hill, for example, suffered periodic incapacity due to the clap, contracted as a cadet. Lower down the hierarchy, Colonel William Douglas of the 9th Ohio Cavalry, operating under Sherman, 1864, complained of men on sick call, the result of their own licentiousness. Debilitation and death through dissipation thin the ranks. "Whiskey and sexual vices carry more soldiers off than the bullet," charged Cyrus Boyd, 15th Iowa, an abstemious soldier. A case in point was the 71st New York's Private Patrick McCarty. Though only 20, he became an alcoholic after signing up, destroying his immune system. Granted a furlough for reenlisting, he spent the whole time in debauch, came back bloated and shaking with incipient delirium tremens, fell sick with typhoid pneumonia, and died as an old man dies whose constitution is enfeebled by age. Unfortunately for moral cleanliness advocates, however, dissipation in fact caused only a minority of the many deaths from disease. In the British Army during the Crimean War, 1854-56, disease produced 4 of 5 deaths, often from post-operative infection. Although the Civil War's 2-to-1 mortality rate of disease to wounds showed improvement, illness remained a personal tragedy and a problem for commanders. In 1861, 20-50% of men in any unit fell sick at one time, afflictions running the gamut. In August 1861, for instance, 645 of the 7th Louisiana's complement of 920 men reported sick. Complaints ranged from acute diarrhea, the commonest problem, to VD, metal poisoning, epilepsy, and mental instability. The high sick rate resulted partly because physicians, keen to get bodies into the building armies, passed men as fit whose physical condition warranted rejection. Inferior specimens, they would fail the challenges of camp life. Private Boyd, the Iowa volunteer cited previously, alleged that the surgeons are not all particular, as the government wants men. and so passed all the boys. Another recruit, Alfred Bellard, 15th New Jersey, recalled that when inducted in 1861, he underwent no examination at all and only had to answer a few questions. Were you ever sick in your life? Have you got the rheumatism? Have you got varicose veins? Medical ignorance of the causes of disease and infection helped promote sickness. Volunteers' ungovernable behavior became another huge ingredient in fostering ill health. Short-term enlistees followed the sloppy example of citizen soldiers in the Mexican War of 1846-48, when disease boosted the U.S. death toll to 104,556. By 1861, the Democratic People's Army still often refused to be told where to defecate and when to wash. Even the well-bred sloughed off, adopting the laxness of a hunting trip. Billets remained unclean. Private Rice C. Bull of the 123rd New York found the Soldiers' Rest in D.C. the most filthy place I was ever in, and crawling with vermin and rats which scampered in all directions. Exacerbating volunteer unruliness, the volume of recruits needing to be accommodated often overwhelmed quartermasters, leading to gross overcrowding. Marcus Woodcock of the 9th Kentucky, U.S., Army of the Ohio, hospitalized for measles November 1861, found 2 patients per bed. The stench was horrible, resulting from the only sanitary arrangement provided, straw piled around the walls. Country boys found packed-in living particularly hard. Unused to cramped conditions, they fell prone to childhood diseases that men from congested urban areas had survived in youth. Mumps, measles, and chickenpox became virulent. Georgia General John B. Gordon recalled, "It was amazing to see the large number of country boys who never had the measles. They ran through the whole category of complaints that boyhood and babyhood are subjected to." Diarrhea and dysentery constituted the commonest diseases, attacking soldiers of all ages and backgrounds. 700 of 1,000 men might have this at a time, physicians treating almost 500,000 cases per year. Causes included poor food, water, and sanitation, so that vast acreages were essentially giant cesspools and garbage dumps. Officers did not always understand the sanitary aspect of their jobs. One report on the State of the Union troops in camp at Cairo, Illinois, 1861, stated, "The company and regimental officers did not know how to care for the men, and the men themselves seemed to be perfectly helpless." Neglect caused needless deaths. New York Private Charles Gould's foot turned septic from an untended cut made while chopping wood. He died of blood poisoning complicated by typhoid fever. Sometimes, failure to seek medical aid came about because field officers distrusted surgeons who, taken on during initial army expansion, revealed their inexperience, even incompetence. The surgeon of the 31st Indiana, for example, treated cases of mumps with a futile application of a caustic solution to the back of the throat, using his swab repeatedly, guaranteeing transmission of the infection from man to man. Most physicians understood the inadequacy of their medical assets. Confederate Assistant Surgeon W.H. Taylor, on duty at a hospital in Charlottesville, Virginia, February 1862, recalled ruefully his only prescriptions for most complaints. "In one pocket of my trousers, I had a ball of blue mass, a mercury compound. In another, a ball of opium. All complaints were asked the same question. How are your bowels? If they were open, I administered a plug of opium. If they were shut, I gave a plug of blue mass." Drug supplies could run short, but in the North, medicines usually remained available, partly due to the efforts of the Women's Central Association of Relief and the U.S. Sanitary Commission. The South suffered a sustained drug shortage, partly due to the Union blockade targeting medical imports. In an environment of overused medical facilities and inadequate hygiene, physicians and nurses also became ill. Confederate Hospital Surgeon Dr. James McIntosh contracted...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.